Welcome to class 11 students. This is the continuation part of the chapter blood body fluids and circulation. In my previous videos I have discussed till anemia. I was discussing the abnormal condition of anemia, and to just give a recap again, anemia is that condition of the body where the body does not have enough functional RBCs, or the hemoglobin content of the RBCs is below normal, is abnormal amount of hemoglobin is present, means lower, very low amount of hemoglobin is present in blood. Okay, now the symptoms or how you can identify a anemic patient, I have discussed those symptoms, and then you have a few types of anemia like megaloblastic anemia, which is due to means the cause of megaloblastic anemia is inadequate intake of vitamin B12 or folic acid. Then you have iron deficiency anemia. From the name only you can understand that this anemia occurs due to the deficiency of iron in the body, or inadequate absorption of iron. You are taking iron, you are eating iron containing foods or iron supplements, but the body cells are unable to absorb iron properly. Okay, or excess loss of iron, that may be due to excess loss of blood, increased iron requirement. The body requires iron much because of some other abnormal condition, and insufficient intake of iron means you're not taking enough iron through your food. Okay, so these are the reasons or causes of iron deficiency anemia. Next you have the pernicious anemia, which is because of inadequate intrinsic factor of gastric juice, which is needed for the absorption of vitamin B12 from small intestine. Then is hemolytic anemia, which is due to the premature rupture of RBC. Then aplastic anemia, due to destruction of red bone marrow for any cause. Suppose a person has undergone any injury and the red bone marrow is destroyed. So you all know that in adult human beings, the hemoglobin is formed, the source of hemoglobin in adults is red bone marrow. So in that case there will be aplastic anemia. And finally thalassemia, it is a hereditary disease. So these are all the different types of anemia that you are going to learn from your book. Let's then move on to white blood corpuscles, WBCs. We have talked about red blood corpuscles in details, about hemoglobin, which is a main part of red blood corpuscles, and then let's move on to WBC. Now previously I have told you that WBCs means the other name of WBC is leukocyte, and they are lesser in number, much lesser than the RBCs. RBCs are the largest in number, they are the most abundant in the blood, and WBCs are lesser in number but larger in size. RBC, they are larger in size than RBCs, and they are nucleated, unlike RBCs which are denucleated, whose nucleus gets disintegrated at the final stage. WBCs have a nucleus throughout their life cycle, and they do not have any pigment, thus colorless or also known as white blood cells. That's it. Now one term that you learned in RBC is erythropoiesis. Here it is leukopoiesis. Okay, what is leukopoiesis? The process of formation of WBC is known as leukopoiesis. The lifespan of WBC is shorter than RBC. They survive in the blood only for a few hours to 15 days. So in case of RBC, the lifespan is 120 days, which is much, much more than that of RBC. And since there are different types of RBC, so we cannot, if anyone asks you what is the lifespan of WBC, you cannot pinpoint one life cycle, because different types of WBCs have different types of lifespans. So you can give a range, which is a few hours to 15 days. But in case of RBC, that is 120 days. Okay. Now we are going to discuss about the different types of WBCs in details, and there you will get to know their structure and what is their function. Okay, so let's move on to that. So previously when I discussed with you about the composition of blood, there I told you that white blood cells are mainly categorized into two types, which are the agranulocytes and the granulocytes. Okay. Now the granulocytes are the neutrophils, this one, neutrophil, eosinophil and basophil. Now what are granulocytes? Those leukocytes that contain cytoplasmic granules and have lobed nucleus. What is lobed nucleus? You can see that in case of neutrophil, it has three lobes, 1, 2, and 3. Three lobes are there. In case of eosinophil, there are two lobes. Moving on to basophil, there are 2.5 kind of lobes. Means generally in case of granulocytes, the nucleus is not like the nucleus that we know. The nucleus, the whole mass of nucleus is divided into 2 to 3 or more lobes. Okay. So and also you can see the grains as well. Here are the grains, here the grains are there, here are the grains. So the granulocytes are those which contain cytoplasmic granules and have lobed nucleus. Now on the basis of the nature of the granules, what type of granules are present in these granulocytes, they are again subdivided into three types, which is neutrophil, then there is eosinophil, and lastly basophil. Now coming to neutrophil, okay. Coming to neutrophil, the first picture, it contains abundant fine granules. You can see that the granules in case of neutrophil are very fine. They are like dots. Okay. And the nucleus is consists of 2 to 7 lobes. Two to seven lobes. Here there are three lobes, right? So the lobes in nucleus can range from 2 to 7. In this particular picture you can see three lobes, and that is why the nucleus of neutrophil is known as a polymorphonucleus. Okay. Neutrophils are about 60 to 70% of the total leukocytes, means the majority of the major type of leukocytes that are found in blood are neutrophils. 60 to 70% are neutrophils, and their main function is, as you can see here, first to respond to a bacteria or a virus. In here it is written as, the function is written as, neutrophils are the first WBCs which respond to a bacteria or a virus. That means any foreign particle, when it enters our body, neutrophils are the first ones to respond to those foreign particles. Okay. So what are the functions? We can say that they are actively amoeboid and phagocytic in action. You know the meaning of phagocytic. Phagocytosis means to engulf solid particles. And amoeboid movement, in case of amoeboid movement, you know that they engulf their food particles or any thing that they want to engulf. So they engulf and destroy the invaded microbes, which are basically the foreign particles. Okay. So this is about the neutrophils. Next, coming to the eosinophils. Here the cytoplasm contains abundant coarse granules. The granules are not fine as in neutrophils. They are quite coarse and they are abundant in number. And here the nucleus is 2 to 3 lobes. 2 to 3 lobes. In this particular picture you can see two lobed nucleus. And what is their main function? Here in this picture you can see it is written, they are known for their role in allergy symptoms. You can also write that they have antihistamine properties. What are antihistamines? Basically, first then I have to talk to you, what are histamines? Histamines are those chemicals in our body which cause allergic reactions, and antihistamines are medicines or those chemicals that we take to stop the allergic reactions. Okay, so this is all about neutrophil and eosinophil. I will continue from basophil in my next video. Okay, thank you.